Princeton University Press Audio presents Birds and Us, a 12,000-year history from cave art to conservation, written and read by Tim Birkhead.
Preface. At the age of six, I was tremendously lucky to have a teacher, Mr. Govett, who was passionate about both birds and art. He read us Arthur Ransome's Great Northern, a story of adventurous children discovering a breeding pair of vanishingly rare Great Northern divers in the Outer Hebrides. We were then tasked with illustrating scenes from the story. Knowing that I liked birds, an interest encouraged by my father, Mr. Govett asked me to paint the bird itself. I still remember the sense of pride in being selected for this special assignment. Little could he have known how this simple act of encouragement would shape my life. That experience was reinforced by an extraordinary coincidence. Walking along a desolate beach on the east coast of Scotland a few years later, my father and I came across a Great Northern diver standing disconsolately on the shore. Its crisp black and white breeding plumage implied it was in perfect condition, but something was wrong, for it made no attempt to move away. Standing awkwardly, as divers do, the bird looked up at us, pitifully it seemed, with its blood-red eyes. It was a victim of oil pollution, which at that time was so common in the world's oceans. I could not believe that the bird I had painted in Mr. Govett's class was here, right in front of me. There was nothing we could do for the unfortunate creature, and when I looked back as we left the shore, it was being chased into the sea by a dog. These two events, I now realise, sowed the seeds of my life, eliciting a passion for birds, a concern for their welfare, a taste for adventure in wild places, and an appreciation of enthusiastic, knowledgeable mentors. Several years on, while in Nova Scotia, waiting for a flight into the high Arctic to study seabirds, I lay in bed at night, listening to the haunting cries of Great Northern divers, or common loons as they're known in North America, echoing eerily across the waters of the nearby lakes. My performance at school was undistinguished, but an interest in natural history and some lucky breaks allowed me to turn an obsession with birds into a career. This has been a calling that allowed me to recognise the many ways that people connect with birds, from those who feed pigeons in urban parks or breed birds in aviaries in their backyards, hunt birds for food or fun, or train racing pigeons like elite athletes, to artists who observe and paint birds in evocative ways. There are myriad ways that we can know birds, and that knowledge, whether professional or amateur, scientific or anecdotal, provides us with a deeper understanding of nature itself. The COVID pandemic saw a surge of interest in birdwatching as a physical and psychological escape from the lockdown restrictions. What better evidence is there for the emotional benefits of the natural world and the need to preserve what's left of it? There's a widely used phrase in conservation biology, the shifting baseline, which bemoans the fact that the current generation has no appreciation for what the natural environment looked like to previous generations, as their only reference is from their childhood. A shifting baseline is just as applicable to our relationship with birds. It is all too easy to imagine that our parents' generation shared the same concern about the worldwide decline in bird numbers, but they didn't. That awareness of a catastrophic decline in many bird populations became apparent only towards the end of the 20th century. Looking a generation or two further back still, attitudes to birds were different, with birds more often being seen as a resource, something to be exploited for meat, feathers, study skins and eggs, or simply destroyed because they interfered with human activities. My aim in this book is to share my enthusiasm for birds and to explain the varied ways that our relationships with them have changed through time. It's a journey that spans several continents and 12 millennia, including my own journey as a bird researcher from the cave art of our Neolithic ancestors through the ancient Egyptians' bird-filled catacombs of the Nile Valley to ancient Greece and Rome and the beginnings of a written history of birds, through the so-called Dark and Middle Ages and a fanatical obsession with falconry to the beginning of science and a reappraisal of classical knowledge, to the pharaohs and a community that for centuries has depended almost entirely on birds. And then to Darwin and the emergence of objective knowledge. we explore the Victorians' mania for specimens and the accumulation of bodies of ornithological knowledge as science gained traction. The 20th century brought us to the beginnings of birdwatching and the field study of birds, triggering an extraordinary flowering of knowledge and empathy for them. Today, there is a massive worldwide interest in birds, from the casual, have you heard a cuckoo yet this spring, through to the more scientific, in which novel discoveries, such as those driven by new tracking technologies, have allowed us to see the migratory journeys of cuckoos and other birds in real time. I've combined my passion for science, art, and history to direct a spotlight on the multiple ways of engaging with birds. This historical, wide-ranging approach is the outcome of a lifetime of ornithological research and public engagement that has emerged from an enduring fascination about where our love of birds and nature as a whole has come from. By drawing attention to the fact that our present, largely empathetic relationship with birds may be temporary, I hope that we may be better able to protect birds into the future. Our story starts in southern Spain, in a little-known Neolithic rock shelter in Andalusia. Our early ancestors are not especially renowned for depicting birds in either carvings or cave paintings, as those are few and far between, but here in this one shallow cave, there are more bird images than all other known caves put together. It's a place that for me marks, like no other, the genesis of our relationship with birds. Chapter 1. Of Peculiar Interest, Neolithic Birds. In 2005, Graham Gibson said, "How long have we been enchanted by birds? Forever, it seems. I've never seen anything quite like it. Cueva del Tajo de las Figuras is hardly a cave by archaeological standards, more a scoop in a vertical sandstone cliff. But inside, it feels as though I'm within the enfolding walls of a womb. With barely enough space to stand upright, the cave spans just 4 metres from one side to the other and 2 metres from front to back. I sit awkwardly on a smooth, upwardly sloping floor, polished by perhaps millions of visitors over millennia, the cave wall just centimetres from my face. It's light, the antithesis of the dark caverns I've been in elsewhere, and in the light I see flocks of birds. This modest, shallow rock shelter is the deep cradle of Western ornithology, the birthplace of bird study. The walls here are covered with an exuberant Neolithic frieze of over 200 birds. Beautifully depicted, mainly in red ochre, but a few in white and yellow, the curved walls and roof are alive with flamingos, herons, raptors, avocets, and many other species, dating back some 8,000 years. This extraordinary abundance of birds in El Tajo was discovered, or rather announced to the world, in the early 1900s by a birdwatcher, Colonel William Willoughby Verner. The locals who told Verner of the cave assumed, as with anything else they didn't understand, that the images were the handiwork of the Moriscos, the Moors, who for 7 centuries had occupied this part of Spain. Multi-talented, Willoughby Verner was a soldier, military historian, natural historian, artist, and intrepid adventurer obsessed by birds. Photographs during his heyday in the 1880s show him with a luxuriant moustache, broad-brimmed hat and an abundance of leather straps and belts and loops bearing his hunting paraphernalia, camera and field glasses. Born in Edinburgh in 1852, Verner was the grown-up version of the archetypal Boy Scout, enthusiastic, energetic, and with a keen interest in wildlife. Like many of his generation, however, Verner was a sportsman, shooting birds and climbing trees and cliffs to collect their eggs. At 22, he joined the Rifle Brigade and was posted to Gibraltar. Later, seeing active service in Africa in both the Nile Campaign, 1884 to 85, and the Boer War in 1899, during which Verner's galloping horse fell and landed on top of him, leaving him horribly injured with a badly broken leg and a displaced heart. Sent back to England, Verner, then aged 52, retired from the army as a colonel in 1904. As soon as he was fit, and he seemed to make a good recovery, albeit with a permanently damaged leg, Verner returned to southern Spain to build himself a house and continue his ornithological pursuits in a region that abounded with bird life. The British had ruled and maintained a garrison on the Rock since the early 1700s. As a result of a trigger-happy officer apparently shooting one of the celebrated apes, a ban on killing Gibraltar's wildlife forced Werner to search further afield for his ornithological trophies. During successive Gibraltar postings during the 1870s and 1880s, Werner spent his leave travelling on horseback through the southwestern corner of Andalusia in search of birds. At this time, rural Spain was a challenging and depressing place for travellers. Richard Ford, in his 1845 Handbook for Travellers in Spain, warned of cheap inns whose bedroom walls are often stained with the marks of nocturnal combat, as he said, of bedbugs, or as he calls them, French ladybirds. As recently as the 1960s, English travellers in Franco's Spain still struggled with the lack of rural hygiene. Werner avoided the risky hospitality by camping or by using his own modest hunting lodge near the tiny town of Tajevia, nestled against his most profitable birding site, the vast wetland known as Laguna Lajanda. His diaries from this time are little more than lists of birds shot and nests robbed. But what lists? The abundance of birds by today's standards is utterly remarkable. Huge flocks of great and little bustards, common cranes, storks, ibises, herons, hawks, ducks and geese. In May 1901, while riding along the desolate northeast edges of Lajanda Lagoon, Werner's Spanish guide, Eduardo Villalba, pointed up to a large rocky outcrop and told him that the El Tajo rock shelter and the Obras de las Moras, works of Moorish origin that contained images of stags, wolves and ibex, also of men and women, and many other things besides, he said. Werner's recent injuries, however, prevented him from climbing up to investigate. Later, he wrote, "So engrossed was I in my pursuit of the birds, and so little did I know all those years that it was the custom of prehistoric man to make drawings in such localities, and above all, that any such drawings could have endured to this day in such open and accessible spots, as were very many of the caves, that I never sought for them." Very few people at this time did know about the customs of prehistoric man. In 1910, Werner was told of another cave further north in the Serrania de Ronda, known as Cueva de la Pileta, Cave of the Pool, with some curious marks on the walls. This time, he and his Spanish travelling companions decided to take a look. Despite his gammy leg, Werner had himself roped up and lowered into the vertical bat-infested cave. Led by José Bion Labato, the man who had discovered the cave on his land, Werner was taken aback by the vast network of limestone caverns decorated with animal images, and as he said, mysterious script and symbols on the walls of its inmost recesses where eternal darkness reigns. Werner's published account of his discovery in the English magazine Saturday Review in 1911 caught the eye of the Pope of Prehistory, as he was called, and the world expert on cave art, the irascible and egotistical Abbé Henri Broy. On the 17th of November 1911, Broy wrote to Werner, arranging to meet and visit the Pileta cave together the following year. During that month-long visit, Broy duly verified the ancient Neolithic origins of the fish, serpents, horses, ibex, bison, and myriad of mysterious signs and symbols painted on Pileta's walls. Impressed by Broy's knowledge and enthusiasm, Werner told him about the paintings he had heard about but not yet seen at El Tajo. Broy was dismissive, doubting that Neolithic images could have survived for so long in such an exposed sandstone site. Broy returned to France, and notwithstanding his scepticism, was obviously excited, for as Werner discovered when he went to examine El Tajo for himself in the autumn of 1913, the Abbé had already sent someone to photograph the cave for him. Was it, I wondered, this seemingly underhand gesture that prompted Werner to put pen to paper and prepare his own account of El Tajo for Country Life magazine the following year? He wrote, "The dull grey and yellow walls and also the roof of this chamber are absolutely covered with rude drawings in dull red. The most conspicuous are those of stags, the largest being over 2 feet in height, with many smaller ones. Of peculiar interest are the birds, of which a variety are shown, some with webbed feet." Broy and Werner subsequently visited El Tajo together, where the Abbé decided that the images were indeed Neolithic. Werner continued, "This small cave, so awkward to reach and so slippery to enter, was in all probability a sanctuary, or place of worship of the folk of the Stone Age. who, during their repeated visits to it, wore the rock to its present highly polished state. A condition he, that is Broy, assured me he has repeatedly found in his explorations of similar caves in other parts of Spain. The paintings are of men, deer, dogs, goats, unknown beasts, and hundreds of birds. Some of the images are tiny, just a few centimetres high, and are so precise and lifelike they must have been painted with a fine brush. Werner and Broy found, as did many of the early visitors to such caves, that the images were more easily seen if dabbed with a damp sponge, not realising that by rendering them more visible in the short term, they were helping to destroy their long-term viability. Wetting encouraged the formation of an obscuring layer of calcite, and indeed when I visited the cave with Cadiz University colleague Dr. Maria Lazarich in the spring of 2019, many of the images were hard to see. Fortunately, both Werner and Broy were competent artists and had independently taken care to trace, photograph and reproduce all the images they saw, so we have a remarkably good representation of what those birds and other animals looked like before they began to fade. I showed Maria a copy of the coloured painting Broy had made of El Tajo's walls and asked her what she thought. "Genio," she said simply. It was true. Broy was extremely talented, not just as an artist, but much else besides. Maria added for good measure that she suspected that both he and possibly Werner too were spies for their respective countries. Despite its ornithological significance, El Tajo remains little known, especially compared with Pileta, Altamira, or the Dordoin caves, and like many of those, it is not open to the public. Its closure was nothing to do with protecting the paintings, but rather the result of a mother suing the local authorities after her daughter fell while trying to climb to the entrance in 2010. After closing the cave to the public, the local hunter installed a metal ladder to provide safe access for the researchers. Looking at the vertical rock wall beneath the entrance to El Tajo, I had wondered how Werner, with his bad leg, and Broy, with his hunchback, he had scoliosis, curvature of the spine, could have climbed up to the entrance. But a photograph in Broy's account shows them using a ridgepole to gain access. Both before and after Broy's comprehensive account of the cave was published in 1929, El Tajo attracted a number of scholars, of which Maria Lazarich and her colleagues are the most recent. Her specific objective has been to identify the birds and understand their significance. There are no fewer than 208 birds on the walls of the cave. Some 150 have been identified as comprising at least 16 different species. The truly remarkable thing about these birds is the realism which they're depicted. They remind me of those end papers of my early Peterson field guide that all birders of my generation will know. But in red ochre rather than black, for the El Tajo images are simple, exquisitely drawn silhouettes of birds in profile. Most abundant are the great bustards, including a spectacular pageant of adult bustards and several tiny chicks. It is this part of the cave wall that intrigues me most. Several convoys of bustards in single file, one above the other, and in some instances painted on the flat surfaces between protruding ridges of harder rock, as though walking along a sunken path. It seems clear, inasmuch that anything in cave art is clear, that the artist cared only about the conformation of the bird's head and body. For it's these features that shout bustard. The legs, on the other hand, are clunky, stumpy and perfunctory, drawn with just two ochre-dipped fingers in a single stroke. Of all the birds the El Tajo hunters pursued, the male great bustard must have been the supreme prize, for at 13 kilograms this is almost the heaviest of all flying birds. Females weigh considerably less, about 5 kilograms. A difference between the sexes that is a consequence of their polygynous mating system. The fact that bustards feature so prominently on the El Tajo walls means that they must have been hunted and eaten. But how the Neolithic hunters caught them on the vast open plains is a mystery. Across the world, different species of bustards have been considered, and I quote, the grandest and most majestic of game birds. And many different ways of catching them have been devised, giving us a clue as to how the El Tajo bustards might have been taken. During the hot, dry Andalusian summer, when the birds are desperate for water, one or more archers may have concealed themselves before dawn beside a pool or stream. As Chapman and Buck speculated, as day begins to dawn, the bustards will take flight in the direction of the water, alighting at a point some few hundred yards distant. They satisfy themselves that no enemy is about, and then, with cautious, stately step, make for their morning draught. As they lower their heads to drink, there is no escape. Another method might, as in India, have involved driving the birds slowly on foot towards an artificial hedge fitted with nooses, where, in trying to pass, the birds snared themselves. Verner tells us both the great bustard and the little bustard were abundant in the Lahanda area. The former lived in groups consisting of a few old males and several females, or the females with their offspring, just as depicted in El Tajo's walls. Of the little bustards, he says, it is a common sight to see flocks of these birds varying from a few dozen to over 100 manoeuvring high in the air. And as he could attest, both species could provide a substantial palatable meal. Also on El Tajo's walls are purple gallinues with their distinctive long toes. Various herons, cattle egrets that seem in some cases to be poking around amongst the deer, a spoonbill, a pair of copulating common cranes near a nest with three eggs, a cluster of greater flamingos with their characteristic down-curved necks and bent beaks, glossy ibis and avocet, eagles or vultures and ducks, all in a carefully depicted panorama. Most of the birds are represented with uncanny realism, but some are schematic, birds in flight on curved wings, like the squished M of gulls drawn in childhood. And squeezed carefully among the birds and the deer, there are mysterious symbols that might be the sun or stars. There are a few people too, an archer with a bow, a man with an axe in one hand and a bird in the other. There is also a man with a bird-shaped headdress, uncannily like the bird hunters of the Indus Valley today, who attach a dead heron to their heads, allowing them to wade within killing range without disturbing their prey. Two features, one topographical, one geographical, provide important clues to understanding the bird images in El Tajo. The first is the cave's proximity to what was once one of Spain's great wetlands, Laguna de Lajanda, a vast expanse of marsh and open water covering 50 square kilometres in the wet winter months in both Neolithic times and in Verner's day. The second is the cave's proximity to the Straits of Gibraltar, the synapse linking Africa and Europe, and the gateway through which millions of migrating birds pass each autumn and spring. The Neolithic people living in this part of Spain enjoyed a massive seasonal abundance of birds. Laguna de Lajanda was drained in the 1960s to create agricultural land. The area is still a birdwatching hotspot with a wealth of wildfowl, herons, egrets and glossy ibis, but a mere shadow of what it must have been previously. The last great bustard here died alone in 2006 after several years of failing to attract a partner. What were the Neolithic people who created the El Tajo bird images like? We know that they used stone tools, made pottery vessels, owned dogs and some domesticated animals, and had a long-standing funerary culture, burying their dead in special tombs with artifacts to speed them on the way to the next life. Below the cave to what would once have been the lake shore, there are remains of houses on the level ground where Neolithic people may have lived. But I suspect that those who visited the Lahanda wetland were essentially nomadic and arrived to coincide with and take advantage of the great seasonal influx of birds. As is clear from their paintings on the cave walls, these people carried axes and used bows and arrows to hunt. They almost certainly used throwing sticks to bring down birds in flight, and they probably also made snares and possibly nets to trap birds in the marshes and surrounding plains. But why did they bother to paint those images of birds, deer, and other animals? When the bison paintings in the Altamira caves in northern Spain were first discovered in the mid-1800s, few could imagine that mere cavemen were capable of creating such astonishing works. Instead, it was widely assumed that the paintings were relatively recent and deliberately designed to mislead. Over the following decades, as more and more cave paintings were discovered across Europe, there was a growing realization that they were truly ancient, and people like Abbé Breuil began to take note and ask what, when, how, and why. The what meant describing the art, animals, humans, geometric shapes. The when involved dating the images, and the how is concerned with the way the images were created, usually iron ore pigments mixed with fat or blood, applied with the fingers or sometimes a simple brush. None of these questions, however, is as problematical as the final one, why? Over the years, this has tested the patience and ingenuity of archaeologists almost to the limit. The way archaeologists have tried to address the why, the purpose, of cave art provides an intriguing comparison with the methods employed by biologists to interpret the behaviours of birds and other animals. The parallels are considerable. Imagine an ornithologist seeing a bird adopt a particular posture or perform a particular display, such as an aerial murmuration. They then ask themselves, why did they do that? What is the purpose of that behaviour? In exactly the same way, an archaeologist such as Broy looking at the bird paintings in El Tajo or the bison and horses in Lascaux would have asked, what was the artist's purpose in creating these images? The explanations offered by archaeologists for the existence of rock art have, like the colours of a chameleon, changed over time. The first idea from the late 1800s and early 1900s was that cave paintings were no more than art for art's sake, decorative and devoid of meaning, reflecting the simple minds of the simple people who created them. Once it was recognised that the Paleolithic and Neolithic people were not the artless, noble savages we once thought, and indeed were cognitively similar to ourselves, this argument was no longer tenable. It was replaced in the 20th century by totemism, the veneration of particular animals and crediting them with certain powers. This idea quickly succumbed when it was realised that instead of being dedicated exclusively to particular species as totemism predicted, most painted caves contained a mixture of animal images. Totemism in turn was replaced by the idea of sympathetic magic, whose roots lay in the early years of the 20th century. Also known as hunting magic, this was the simultaneously utilitarian and magical notion that creating or possessing an image of an animal imbued one with power over it, especially with respect to hunting. And this is what Abbé Broy believed. And were it true, it might represent the beginning of the so-called man's domination of nature, an idea that later would become a core part of Christian belief. The blow that knocked the spell out of sympathetic magic in the mid-20th century was the lack of concordance between the animals illustrated on the cave walls and what, based on archaeological remains, the occupants of those caves actually ate. Once magic was dispelled, it was replaced in the late 1980s by shamanism. This was an idea informed and elevated by the discipline of neurophysiology and proposed that cave images were created by shamans whose objective was to use self-induced hallucinations to deal with supernatural phenomena such as drought, for example by summoning rain, or sickness, for example by seeking cures. This hypothesis was devised mainly to explain the otherwise unintelligible geometric shapes that decorate many caves, including Pileta, and to a lesser extent, El Tajo. Such patterns, it was argued, were visual representations of so-called entoptic phenomena, that is, visual effects from within the eye itself, the kinds of things you see during a migraine and, I'm told, during altered states of consciousness as a result of taking hallucinogenic drugs. Is it a coincidence that the timing of the shamanistic hypothesis in the 1980s coincided with an increasingly open drugs culture? The cave art aficionado, Jean Klotz, argued that the similarity of Paleolithic cave art over much of the Northern Hemisphere is in line with a widespread shamanism or religiosity. He asserts also that the extraordinary aesthetics and remarkable naturalism of many cave images is consistent with them having been produced by a few highly trained, talented individuals, which, he says, is consistent with a shamanistic or religious interpretation. The sense of awe one experiences on penetrating deep inside a cave to eventually look upon a frieze of bison, horses or woolly rhinoceroses painted as though they were emerging from the rock itself is the same as entering a cathedral and viewing a magnificent stained glass window or an elaborately carved altarpiece. I was sceptical of the entoptic idea. Not that such visual effects don't occur, we all know they do, but I find it hard to imagine that they might be the inspiration for the geometric symbols found in caves. Then, the night after first seeing the El Tajo paintings, my sleep was a vivid, shifting jumble of ochre-red images, and a few days later, with the visit still echoing in my head, I sat in the sun with closed eyes, only to see the entire array of El Tajo. those images, both naturalistic and symbolic, come and go inside my eyelids against the sun. I was suddenly aware that entoptic phenomena could be very real, albeit in this case as a result of seeing the art rather than providing its inspiration. I then realised just how easy it was for a burst of euphoria to delude me into thinking that I too might be a shaman. In science, explanations for particular phenomena change over time too, but those changes are usually based on evidence. This hasn't been the case in cave art. There is increasing evidence of sorts as more and more discoveries are made, but new discoveries do little to help researchers devise rigorous tests of the various hypotheses that have been suggested to explain why cave art was created. Some archaeologists feel that even trying to identify the purpose of cave art is pointless. I think it might be too, but it's difficult to resist. What is so striking about the Altaco birds is their lifelike realism. They're depicted as though they're being observed or hunted from a distance. Compare and contrast this with the 17th century Dutch or Italian paintings of birds laid lifeless upon kitchen slabs. The ability of recent researchers to identify the different bird types in El Tajo is a reflection of just how well observed and rendered they were by their creators. In some ways, we shouldn't be too surprised at this. The success of Neolithic people depended on their abilities to capture their prey, be it in the flesh or in red ochre. And unlike most of us today, they lived much more intimately with the natural world. Apart from native hunters, only a few wildlife cameramen or field biologists spend long enough watching wildlife ever to come close to the experience of our Neolithic ancestors. What the El Tajo artists achieved was more than mere illustration. Creating those images forced others to see the birds differently. I wonder how many of today's bird watchers would be able to create tiny images of particular birds that were instantly recognisable by others. The El Tajo painters didn't sit down and sketch a dead bird or even a live one. Rather, they had in their mind's eye the true essence of each species that they then transferred onto the cave walls. Possibly, just possibly, the El Tajo birds served as a field guide. Come here, climb up carefully into this shallow rock shelter and see what's drawn in vibrant red, yellow and white upon the walls. Look at them, look hard. At the different types, long necks, short necks, long legs, straight beaks, hooked beaks, and see the eggs in the nest on the ground. Now, turn around and look out across the limitless wetland in front of you. Soon, in the spring, the birds will come. They'll come in their thousands, millions even, from the direction of the sea, and we will feast on them. But to hunt them effectively, you will need to know them. Not just the different types shown here, but the way they behave, the way they feed and breed in the marshes. Knowledge here is power. Of course, bird iconography, much older than El Tajo's Neolithic images, exist. Both Neanderthals and modern humans in the Paleolithic exploited birds for food and for body parts, feathers, talons, beaks and bones, for ritual purposes. Paleolithic people also created images of birds on both portable artifacts and on the walls of caves and rock shelters. But the truth is that Paleolithic bird images and artifacts are extremely thinly spread through space and time, which is why the abundance of birds in the El Tajo rock shelter is so extraordinary. These are the most abundant, the most diverse, and the most accurately depicted birds in all cave art. They lack the grandeur of some of the better-known cave paintings, but this is partly because the mammoths, lions, and aurochs and other Paleolithic megafauna were extinct by the time the El Tajo people were painting. These wonderful bird images were created on the cusp of the transition from foraging to farming, the western endpoint of the spread of agriculture from the Fertile Crescent that reached as far south as the Nile Valley around 6,500 BC. Striking similarities exist between southern Spain and Egypt. Both enjoyed vast wetlands, Laguna del Hanna and the River Nile respectively. They were wonderfully rich in migratory bird life amidst hot summers and inhospitable terrain. The crucial difference was that the annual floodwaters of the Nile poured fertility onto the desert stands, allowing the ancient Egyptians to start farming and on a truly grand scale. The agricultural surpluses they generated provided the foundation of a sophisticated society with elaborate beliefs, with, as we'll see in the next chapter, birds at their very heart. Chapter 2. Inside the Catacombs, the Birds of Ancient Egypt. In 1989, Juliet Clutton-Brock said the following: "Never again will human beings be able to rival the intense involvement with animals that was such an integral part of the ancient Egyptian civilization." 4 million is a number I have difficulty imagining. It's 8 times as many people as reside in Sheffield, the city where I live. Yet 4 million is the number of mummified birds, mainly sacred ibises, discovered in the vast subterranean catacombs at Tuna el Gabel in Egypt in the early 1800s. Encased in ceramic jars or wooden coffins, the mummies were stacked meters high in subterranean cells carved from the soft desert rock. And it wasn't just here. Throughout the entire 1,000-kilometre length of the Nile Valley, from Lake Nasser in the south to Alexandria in the north, archaeologists have found over 80 animal cemeteries, 31 of which contain sacred ibises. So carefully preserved are the birds that they are still with us now, in their afterlife, our present. Unwrapped, some of the ibis mummies have the solidity of bronze sculptures, eerily reminiscent of human bog bodies. The presence of so many bird mummies, together with the numerous bird hieroglyphs and exquisite images of birds on tomb walls, reveals a society intimately engaged with birds. Egypt's civilization was a direct consequence of the Nile. The river's seasonal floodwaters, together with an ingenious man-made irrigation system, provided an annual dressing of fertile silt to the surrounding desert lands that resulted in prodigious agricultural productivity. The shift from foraging to farming, what archaeologists term the agricultural revolution, occurred some 10,000 years ago, and did so independently in different parts of the world and at slightly different times. In Egypt, the shift seems to have occurred about 8,000 BC. It was also the shift from nomadism to more settled living. For the cultivation of crops such as wheat forced farmers to live near their fields. Dependence on one or two agricultural plants made farmers vulnerable to the vagaries of the weather, floods and droughts. And it was probably this that bound the agricultural revolution to a religious revolution. Devotion to gods in exchange for abundant harvests and sets of shared beliefs that allowed people to work together. The abundance of agricultural produce, supplemented by the vast number of waterfowl and fish that lived in the marshes, provided the leisure, lifeblood and inspiration for the development of Egypt's elaborate culture. It was a culture in which one's presence on earth was a mere stepping stone to the afterlife. Benevolent gods were called upon for protection. Dangerous gods required appeasement, processes that demanded offerings. During his 31-year reign between 1187 and 1157 BC, the pharaoh Ramses III made offerings to the gods of no fewer than 680,714 birds, some 20,000 per year, at various temples. During the so-called late period of Egyptian civilization between 672 and 332 BC, animal gods were common, taking a variety of forms, including avian. Indeed, the distinction between human and non-human worlds was extremely vague. Life after death, eternal life, was a cornerstone of Egyptian culture, hence its preoccupation with the preservation of human bodies through mummification. The poor were buried in the desert sands and desiccated by the Sahara's dry heat. The elite were eviscerated and embalmed in an elaborate process of mummification and deposited in wooden or stone sarcophagi inside beautifully decorated burial chambers. The Nile was as important a source of sustenance for the birds as it was for people, a major migration flyway for birds moving north in spring and south in autumn. Adjacent wetlands provided food and sanctuary for many overwintering birds, just as Laguna de la Janda once did in Spain. From as long ago as 3700 BC, it seemed, birds had winged their way into every corner of Egyptian culture. They provided food and recreation, but their ability to fly meant they were revered as the link between heaven and earth, between the present and the future. The mass appearance of migratory birds, ducks, geese, herons, storks, ibises and quail, at particular times of year, were emblems of new life, a reenactment of the moment of creation and the conquest of death. In a society so taken up with symbols, gods and the afterlife, it is little wonder that birds played such a vital role. As one writer commented, all human beings were, symbolically, imparted with avian characteristics. The unique cultural partnership between the ancient Egyptians and birds must have started with their Paleolithic ancestors exploiting the seasonal influx of birds into the Nile Valley as food. The transition from hunter-gatherers to the extraordinarily sophisticated civilization that we think of as ancient Egypt was mediated by an abundance of food and a settled lifestyle. The Egyptians hunted birds using a variety of techniques, including bows and arrows and throwing sticks, as had Paleolithic and Neolithic people elsewhere. But they also developed much more efficient ways of catching birds. Egyptian clap nets were of two general types: a small version for capturing individual birds with a central perch trigger, and a larger one for catching multiple birds simultaneously, which comprised two net panels laid flat on the ground and held in position by ropes under tension. On pulling a release rope, the two panels clapped together instantly through 180 degrees, imprisoning any birds that were between them. With birds lured into the trapping area by bait or through the use of decoys, the clap net was a contrivance of devastating efficiency. Decoy birds were another novelty. These were tame or tethered individuals that, like the half-bird, half-beautiful women sirens of Greek mythology, lured their wild counterparts to their doom. In Egypt, decoys were herons, bitterns or geese tied to the prow of a boat, whose presence, as it made its way through the marshes, attracted or reassured the wild birds, drawing them within killing range. The remarkable thing about a heron decoy is it reassures not just their own kind, but also other species like ducks and geese. When I first heard of this, I was suspicious, but its effectiveness is verified by several others, including the author of a 17th century book on hunting. A fowler who wishes to obtain a multitude of waterfowl with a net need only utilize a decoy heron. And indeed, this method was still in use in the Nile Delta in the 1930s. We know all this because of the Egyptians' extraordinary artworks, tomb paintings, engravings, sculptures and hieroglyphs. The sheer abundance and diversity of birds that the Egyptians illustrated is extraordinary. They were obsessed by them. Among the multitude of images, one of the most beautiful is from the tomb chapel of Nebaman, known as Fowling in the Marshes. Nebaman was an elite official, a grain accountant, at the Temple of Karnak, who died around 1350 BC. Wheat was the single most important agricultural commodity in the Nile Valley, so it's hardly surprising that Nebaman received a special burial and is the proud focus of this scene. He stands, legs astride, on a small boat, holding some decoy birds, possibly egrets, in one hand and a snake-headed throwing stick in the other, amidst a multitude of exquisitely drawn birds, butterflies and fish. Also in the painting are his beautiful wife and young daughter. The birds include an immature African finfoot, various ducks, herons, egrets, geese and a wagtail. At one level, you could view this painting as a simple record of a happy hunting day. At another, it has been suggested that this is Nebaman ridding the world of chaos, represented by the explosion of birds rising from the papyrus swamp around him. Most probably, the image simply depicts Nebaman's vision of his afterlife. The tombs and tomb chapels of the Egyptian elite were designed and decorated to inspire awe among worshippers, which even in their current decayed and often desecrated state, they still do. Entering an Egyptian tomb induces an overwhelming sense of wonder, and one feels consumed by the primordial richness of the blood-red ochre pigments that seem to trigger something deeply elemental within our brains. That the artwork in Paleolithic and Neolithic caves generates the same sensations is no coincidence. Egyptian burial chambers are simply rectilinear caves decorated in a more ornate manner. The Nebaman tomb was discovered in the 1800s by Giovanni, that is Yanni, de Athanasi, a Greek-born employee of Henry Salt, British Consul General in Egypt, who, with encouragement from Joseph Banks, the President of the Royal Society, had become an enthusiastic collector of Egyptian artifacts. Yanni excelled at finding previously undiscovered tombs of the long-dead Egyptian elite. At that time, archaeology, if we dare call it that, was a free-for-all, with private individuals grabbing what they could, either for their own collections or to sell to museums. Such was the frenzied rivalry over the location of sites, Yanni never revealed the whereabouts of the Nebbermann tomb. In an account written in 1836, soon after its remarkable treasures became known, it was said, "We cannot learn from what part of Egypt they came, nor in what kind of place they were found." Extensive research since then has placed the Nebbermann tomb somewhere on the west bank at Thebes, that is present-day Luxor. In what seems like an unspeakable act of vandalism, Yanni's workmen removed the most attractive images from the Nebbermann chamber, cutting into the plaster surface with knives and saws. He wrote, "Sometimes they removed the full depth of the mud plaster, but sometimes they carried away only a very thin layer, and the edges inevitably suffered cracking and disintegration. Burial tombs themselves were cut from the soft limestone and marl, and then plastered over with a mixture of mud and plant material, including flowers and cereal straw, and finished off with a layer of fine plaster onto which the artists produced their images. The vegetation that gave the mud layer its original robustness eventually and inevitably decayed, rendering it particularly fragile." And there are several instances where Yanni abandoned the attempt to remove an image because he realised it would not survive. In October 1821, while in Alexandria, Henry Salt wrote to his agent describing a shipment of artefacts he was about to send back to Britain. "The 10 smaller cases contain Egyptian paintings taken from the wall of a tomb underground, discovered by my man," that is Yanni, "last year in 1820, and which I hope will arrive in good preservation. Some care must be taken in carrying them, as jolting would probably destroy them." These were the Nebbermann tomb paintings, and they arrived at the British Museum in late 1821. Sadly, they probably represent only a fraction of what once covered the chapel walls. The museum staff had two priorities. The first was to make tracings of the paintings that could be later used to create watercolour copies. The second was to find a way of strengthening and securing the originals so they could be displayed. To accomplish this, they were placed face down and wet plaster of Paris poured onto the back of them. Once the plaster was dry, the pictures could be handled more safely. They were then put into a wooden frame with more plaster added to the back. Thus secured, the paintings were placed on public display for the first time in 1835 in the museum's Egyptian saloon, as illustrative of the domestic habits of the Egyptians. I've been unable to find any record of how the Nebbermann tomb paintings were first received by the public, but throughout the 19th century, they and other Egyptian artworks caused a sensation, inspiring contemporary artists including Lawrence Alma Tadema, Edward Poynter, Edwin Long, and even Paul Gauguin, to create their own, often exotic or erotic, images. But all was not well. Despite their best intentions, the method used by the museum staff to preserve the tomb paintings proved disastrous, for as the water in the plaster evaporated, it did so through the surface of the paintings, causing discoloration, fading, and deterioration. It wasn't just the removed artworks that were deteriorating. The state of those still remaining in the tombs was declining too. Exposed to the air and light for the first time by plunderers and archaeologists, tomb paintings were scratched and splattered by roosting bats and faded by the sun. To preserve them, even in situ, urgent action was needed. And in the early 1900s, historians recognised that it was vital to make copies before it was too late. Some of the most precise and perfect were executed by Nina de Garis Davis, whose partner, Norman de Garis Davis, was in charge of the Egypt Exploration Fund's archaeological survey. Prior to the introduction of colour photography, painting was the only way of reproducing colour images on the spot, and Nina, who produced numerous copies of tomb paintings, was regarded as the best exponent. Her paintings were included in her and her husband's books and were exhibited at the Victoria and Albert Museum, with almost all the originals purchased by Alan H. Gardner, at the time the UK's preeminent Egyptologist. The diversity of birds in Egyptian iconography is remarkable, and in the case of tomb paintings, executed in exquisite lifelike detail, albeit in profile. In this respect, the ancient artists were like those of present-day field guides, whose flat, idealized but accurate images instantly allow the viewer to identify the species in question. The Egyptians included images of over 70 different species of birds, hounded, herded, and hunted. In Tutankhamun's tomb, we see the boy king as an archer hunting ostriches with a dog from a chariot. There are birds caught by cats, birds mobbing a mongoose attempting to steal their chicks, a hovering pied kingfisher about to plunge into the water. In others, there are men with throwing sticks capturing flocks of ducks in clap nets and netting golden orioles to protect the sycamore figs on which they feed. There are priests herding white pelicans and common cranes, demoiselle cranes and geese, baskets of Dalmatian pelican eggs, tethered herons and bitterns, black kites guarding a tomb, and men force-feeding geese and common cranes. There are birds without people, spoonbills and flamingos, griffin vultures as gods or goddesses, Horus falcons, a barn owl on its nest, and a bat, an honorary bird, as it continued to be until the mid-1600s. Not surprisingly, birds feature prominently in Egyptian hieroglyphs. Each one, like all other hieroglyphs, represented a particular sound, word, or thought. Some of the 50 or so bird hieroglyphs are identifiable as particular species, such as the Eurasian hoopoe, northern lapwing, and northern bald ibis. Others, such as herons, hawks, and ducks, are more generic. Recognizing which species is represented is crucial for understanding its significance. The scenes depicted in burial chambers not only show hunting, but may also provide evidence of the start of domestication, people herding flocks. It's been suggested that these scenes indicate the domestication of ostriches, cranes, ibis, geese, ducks, among others. But domestication depends not only on captivity, but also breeding successive generations of captive animals. And there's little evidence of this in ancient Egypt. For those adventurers undertaking the Grand Tour and brave enough to venture into Egypt, the bird pits at Saqqara were a must. The German theologian Johann Michael of Wanzleb described how in 1672 he and his colleagues had ropes tied around their middles and were lowered down into what he calls a well. At the bottom, they lit their tapers and, crawling on their bellies, crept into a vast catacomb. There they saw what they said was many large stores full of earthen pots, in which there were embalmed birds of all kinds, every bird in its own pot. We also found some hen's eggs, empty but entire, without any ill smell or crack. William Wilde, Oscar's father, a medic and amateur archaeologist visiting the mummy pits of Saqqara in the 1830s, wrote, "All was utter blackness. I contrived to scramble through a burrow of sand and sharp bits of pottery, frequently scraping my back against the roof. This continued through many windings for upwards of quarter of an hour, and again I was on the point of returning. As half suffocated with heat and exertion and choked with sand, I lay panting in some gloomy corner. I do not think in all my travel I ever felt the same strong sensation of being in an enchanted place, such as when led through the dark winding passages and lonely vaults of this immense mausoleum." The existence of Egypt's human mummies has been known and written about since about 430 BC, when Herodotus described them. Their presumed medicinal qualities had been known, or rather assumed, since at least Shakespeare's time, when travellers started to bring human mummies back to England. The demand for mummy, as this medicine was called, was greater in France than in any other country, and the ornithologist Pierre Ballon, who was travelling in Egypt in the late 1540s, tells how King Francois I was in the habit of always carrying about him a little packet containing some mummy mixed with pulverised rhubarb, ready to take upon receiving any injury from falls or other accidents that might happen to him. Sir Thomas Browne, writing in the 1650s, lamented the business of, as he said, turning old heroes into unworthy potions. Interestingly, the process of human mummification occurred first, as far as we know, in Peru and Chile about 7,000 years ago, 2,000 years before it started in Egypt. In 2019, while in Peru, I saw that sarcophagi containing mummies also contain mummified birds, including toucans. But little is known about these pre-Columbian cultures, so it is unclear whether these mummified birds were food items, pets, or votive offerings. When Napoleon's army invaded Egypt in 1798, the spoils of war involved many ancient artifacts, including a large number of human and non-human mummies, birds, crocodiles, shrews, beetles, and a lot of cats, all from the catacombs at Saqqara and Thebes. Back in Europe, the unwrapping of mummies became a party piece for the upper classes in both French and English salons. I saw my first unwrapped human mummy in Norwich Museum when I was 5 or 6 years old. It's an image that has remained with me to this day. Napoleon's huge invading entourage included no fewer than 150 civilian savants, whose job was to produce the massive multi-volume Description de l'Égypte, published between 1809 and 1829, that epitomised the link between science and empire that so characterised this era. Napoleon's trove of ancient treasure brought Egyptology into the public imagination, triggering a gold rush for more. As one writer said, the long tradition of travellers' accounts portrayed Egypt as the precursor of classical civilization fallen under tyrannical government, and served to justify Napoleon's imperialistic aspirations. The British were no different, and competed with Napoleon for Egypt's riches, plundered from tombs, and whose acquisition they justified by comparison with what they said was a lost child restored to the great family of science and art, which is of no country whose home is the world. There was no shortage of animal mummies. A media report from 1890 described how a cargo ship arriving at Liverpool docks contained 19 tons of cat mummies, some of which were subsequently auctioned off to museums, the rest being sold as fertiliser. At that time, animal mummies were considered worthless, and as late as the 1930s, local people were still plundering the catacombs to use them as fertiliser. Indeed, the academic study of non-human mummies did not begin until the late 1970s, since when it's become something of a niche area of research, but one with considerable public fascination. Mummies of no fewer than 90 different bird species have been found at Tuna El Gebel, probably representing almost all the birds likely to have occurred in that region. Ibises are the most abundant, followed by birds of prey, and many other species represented by only a handful of specimens. Interestingly, only the ibises and the raptors were mummified in their entirety. The rest were represented by just a single bone or feather. Some mummies contained birds' eggs or nest material. In other words, anything bird-related was preserved, presumably by people taking what they found to the embalmers. As the French naturalist Bernard Lazapet said, the ancient Egyptians, with their obsession for mummifying, had inadvertently created a nearly complete cabinet of curiosities. It's now thought that bird mummies served four different purposes: preserving the birds as food, pets for deceased humans, as gods to be revered, and as votive offerings. The victual mummies of Tutankhamun's funerary meal comprise four different species of geese, five different ducks, and a few European turtle doves. Birds were not common as mummified pets. Cats were far more popular, as were dogs, lion cubs, gazelles, and monkeys. Tomb paintings of hoopoes held in the hands of children are assumed to have been pets, although hoopoe mummies are quite scarce. The ibis was sacred and represented by the god Thoth. In fact, all birds were sacred to some extent, but Thoth, the god of wisdom and writing, was special. It was apparently thought that the ibis's long, dark-tipped bill resembled a writing quill. It was also believed that ibises killed snakes, as was said, turning away a great plague from Egypt when they kill and consume those flying serpents that are brought thither by the west wind out of the deserts of Libya. In fact, ibises rarely eat snakes, and Herodotus, who related this story, may have muddled ibises with storks, who do snack on serpents. The Egyptians may have revered ibises as consumers of other pests like locusts that threaten their crops. Other birds, such as hawks, were revered for their speed, bravery, or savagery, but ibises, it seems, were considered unclean because of their scavenging habits, and hence were either inedible or poisonous. Otherwise, I'm sure they would have been on the Egyptian menu. Where did these millions of ibises come from? Were they taken from the wild? Were they reared in captivity like so many chickens, or some wild and some reared. It's odd that there exist tomb images of ostriches, cranes and ducks and geese being tended, herded and force-fed, but very few ibises. Does this mean that the ibises were taken from the wild? Probably not, for neither are there any hunting scenes involving ibises nor ibises in clapnets. One possibility is that their sacred state meant that ibises were excluded from tomb paintings. There is, however, good evidence for the existence of ibis sanctuaries. These could have been places to which wild ibises were attracted through the existence or creation of marshy habitat and the provision of food. If they were sufficiently attractive, such sites would act as self-filling reservoirs of wild birds from which the officiating priests could harvest what they wanted. Another possibility is that ibis sanctuaries were places where the birds were hatched and hand-reared. The ancient Egyptians pioneered artificial incubation, possibly as early as 3000 BC, but certainly in the last few centuries BC, exactly when the production of ibis mummies was at its peak. The 18th century writer and savant René-Antoine Verschoelt de Réaumur, who was trying to develop an artificial incubation system for chickens, declared that Egypt ought to be prouder of her success with hatcheries than of her pyramids. He was right, because notwithstanding the success of the Egyptians, it took Europeans and North American researchers until the 19th century to figure out how to incubate eggs artificially. For a long time, the origin of the Egyptians' artificial incubation system was thought to be lost in antiquity. Since then, evidence of ibis hatcheries has come to light.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.